Hello everybody.
Hello.
Thanks for coming along this evening. Congratulations on your new premises. And thank you to Central St Martin's for inviting the Faber Social to host this room of conversations and readings tonight. A little bit of background about Faber Social. Obviously we're related to close cousin of Faber and Faber Publishers. I'm the publishing director of Faber. We set up the Faber Social in June in association with Heavenly and the Social on Little Portland Street. Monthly readings, performances, music, conversation, and good chat at any social occasion should involve. It's going very well. Come down first Monday of every month if you can, and you'll hear some very interesting writers and some conversation. Tonight, principally, it's going to be structured in three parts, three panel discussions, the first of which we're about to have. Each will last about 45 minutes. In between that, there will be some readings, and there'll also be some music from Beth Hirsch. So tonight you're going to hear from musicians, from DJs, from poets, from novelists, from designers, from photographers, from a whole range of people from across the arts, and I hope you'll find the evening enjoyable. Now, I'm just going to hand over to Adrian Shaugnessy, a graphic designer, writer based in London who runs Shaugnessy Works, which is a consultancy combining design and editorial direction. He writes for I, Creative Review and Design Week. In 2010, he was appointed visiting professor for the Royal College of Art. Adrian has said of graphic design, it's like a wine glass, which is appropriate seeing as there are quite a few wine glasses on the table. When we drink wine, we barely notice the glass it is served in. It wouldn't be true to say we don't care what we drink out of. We wouldn't choose to drink a rare vintage out of a Tupperware mug, for example. But it's the wine that matters, not the vessel it comes in. So Adrian will introduce the panel and lead a discussion about record sleeve art and design, past, present and future, and its relationship to wine glasses. So thank you. Please welcome Adrian Shaugnessy. He'll introduce me.
I should just say that the reference to a wine glass is actually a famous quote by somebody else. I adapted it, but it's a famous quote by a female typographer from the 1940s, I think. I mentioned that it's a female typographer because we were supposed tonight to have a female member of the panel. They come to you as a bit of a surprise that you asked to develop as a female. And she, unfortunately, Kate Morris, who I was very keen had on this panel, takes not very well, I gather, and can't make it, so that's why it's an all-male panel. Anyway, we're going to talk about record covers, record sleeves, past, present, and future. They've certainly got a past. We've all got record collections, I'm assuming, and we can go right back and look at these wonderful, iconic images that, for many of us, represent huge chunks of our lives. It's kind of got a present. We'll talk about that with our practitioners on the panel who are designing record covers, even as we speak. But does it have a future? Because I really wonder whether it has. Record shops are closing. EMI, only major British record label, was owned by a bank until a few days ago. I think it's been sold to a French utilities company now. So what does that mean for record covers? But let's not be too pessimistic. Let's see if there's any optimism. I'm actually going to be a very lazy MC. I'm going to ask the panel to introduce themselves. They've each brought a short presentation of their work. And I think if they show you what they do, we've got two photographers and two graphic designers. If they show you what they do, then I think the discussion might have a bit more substance. So, Bob, I'm going to ask you to start.
Okay.
Pick up the
presentation spot. Okay. Hi, I'm Bob Gruen, and I live in New York City, where I was born. My mom's hobby was photography, and I learned it from her. And I got my first photo pass at the Newport Folk Festival in 1965 when Bob Dylan shocked the crowd by playing with a rock band. And I saw Tina Turner, and I got this great shot here, and a few days after that, at another show, I happened to meet Ike Turner, and he liked my photos. And he took me to Los Angeles, where I made my first album cover, this picture of Tina Turner, which was done in while she was shopping for groceries. Through Argentina, I met many people, and I met the manager of LaBelle, and I did a lot of album covers for them. And they were a lot of fun. They liked to go to unusual places, like the Boys Club gym, where we took these pictures. And then I met John Lennon through an interview, and a photo I took that first night was used on his Sometime in New York City album cover. And a few years later, he called and asked me to make the photos for the Walls and Bridges album, with strips that flipped over to make different expressions. We took the photos on the roof of his penthouse, and then we took some more photos around the roof, and we made this one, my most well-known photo, with a New York City t-shirt I had given him a year earlier. And I met more people in the music business, and I got photo passes for the Rolling Stones, and I started working with Cream magazine and Lisa Robinson, who was a big photo editor at the time and syndicated to a lot of different newspapers. And she took me to see Led Zeppelin, and when we got to the airport, Robert Plant asked me to take a picture of them with their plane, which seemed like no big deal at the time, but it's become one of those most well-known photos of Led Zeppelin. And I only saw them a few times, but my photos of them were very popular, and one was the cover for Rolling Stone magazine. And I also did lots of obscure albums, like Roy Buchanan and a band called Smiths, Under Their Wings. And this photo of Genesis, which was very difficult. They were just starting out, and part of their show was played in infrared light. So it was kind of hard to get this picture, but it's kind of a popular one. And then I started working with the New York Dolls. And I did their second album cover and many of the compilations that came out for them over the years. And working with Rock Scene magazine opened a lot of doors for me, because we covered the whole scene and not just on-stage photos. And I got to know Debbie Harry through Rock Scene and lots of other bands. And I made a story about Kiss for Cream magazine. And the band liked the picture so much they used it for the cover of their album, and they called it Dressed to Kill. And this design won a lot of awards because the band's name was embossed on the cover and not just printed there. I first came to England in 1976, and Malcolm McLaren introduced me to the Sex Pistols and the whole English punk scene. And then I'm going across America with the Sex Pistols a few years later. And then I got to know the Clash as well. I traveled with them for two tours across the US. And I didn't make any album covers for them, but I did lots of magazine covers. They're one of my favorite bands, and it was great to work with them because they were very aware of their image, and they always took a lot of attention to what they were wearing and how they looked. One of my favorite album covers actually I did for Sheena and the Rockets, who's a band from Japan. I was friends with them, and they came to New York, and I made photos for them, and then I booked a place for them to record, and I booked a show for them, and then I printed a poster from the photos I had taken. And then on the way to the show, I took a photo of them in front of the poster, and that was the album cover. And one of the more fun sessions I did was this one, The Fun-Loving Criminals, wanted to reproduce the Jimi Hendrix Electric Ladyland album, which is a big poster here in London. And nowadays, my photos are often used in reissues, like this John Lennon photo that came out with a big package last year, and it was a theme of ads around the world. And I'm in London now to promote the release of my new book, Rock Scene, which is a hardcover collection of my career, and an introduction by Debbie Harry. And it'll be on sale actually, out in the hallway here. I'll be signing copies if you'd like to get a copy tonight. Thanks for having me here.
Thank you, Bob. Okay, our next speaker is Luke Insect. I was just going to say, could we hit the lights up, you think, at the front there?
Yeah. My name's Luke, I'm a design company
illustrative. I think I'm starting to get more work from smaller upcoming labels and independent artists that maybe haven't got the big budgets to work with, say, big photographers just starting out, so they maybe want something that's more graphic, more illustrative, more kind of, an original piece rather than, you know, the big technical setup of a four-day photo shoot or whatever. A lot of my work is inspired by kind of psychedelia, colours, design, geometrics. Sleeve I did recently kind of sums up a lot of my kind of major influences, which is I collect vinyls. I'm a big sort of vinyl collector, and I will be until I die. This is kind of a collection of royalty-free images and montage put together for an artist called Richard Norris, who who was inspired himself by psychedelics and electronics from the 60s and 70s, but was trying to do something kind of futuristic with it. So he wanted a designer to maybe take from the past, but look to the future as well. Next slide shows the other kind of end of the spectrum. This is again using lots of vintage kind of imagery. My biggest problem was coming up against the copyright-free kind of infringement laws, but there's a basic rule that if the person who took the photograph has been dead for 70 years, then it's usable. But there's also another rule: you can take images that you find on the internet or in old magazines or fanzines, and there's a 65% degree of change that you have to apply to them. So maybe I'll take a photograph of a famous kind of icon from the 60s, but if I mess around with it, screen print it, fuck it up a bit, kind of recolour it, and then you can kind of get away with using it. So I'm kind of like a cut and paste artist, I suppose, like a lot of modern days samplers and hip hop artists, whatever. Those are vintage analog kind of imagery for an artist who again use lots of samples and imagery from the 60s and 70s to kind of create this forward thinking music. Next slide. On the other side of the spectrum, I do still get asked to do the number one selling, number one charts and platinum selling albums. And that's kind of when I do have to tailor my sort of style a little bit. Although I have again used a kind of vintage photo from 1910 that was clearly copyright free. I think people discovered. But the thing I find, although I have a very kind of maximalist style, I like cramming in as much as possible into the kind of canvas of the sleeve. I'm finding more and more that my artwork is being reduced to a 72 pixel iTunes JPEG. So although a lot of artists do still release stuff on 12 like the previous two sleeves, when it came to working with a Prodigy, I did have to think about the fact that a lot of people don't even see this big, and hence, although it's still being quite gritty and retro in style, it's kind of simplified right down to bare essentials. The other problem I have is when artists seem to want to be in their sleeve despite not having a budget for a professional photo shoot. So sometimes I'll say, look, we want a kind of mad sleeve, we've got a few hundred quid for it, but here's a snapshot I took of myself in my friend's bedroom on an iPhone and can do something with it, which at first, after battling if there's a way of incorporating the kind of image into something illustrative or kind of abstract and making it a one with the kind of surrounding graphics, then maybe it could work. I mean, for example, this kind of singer-songwriter, I got some terrible kind of holiday photo shot in 1976 in the south of France. Shot that big, had to clean it up a bit, but I think because of her style, which was kind of psychedelic, acid, folk, it kind of worked that we could take this kind of vintage image and put it in my own kind of dark illustrative kind of background. Next one. And similarly, this band recently, kind of a pop new wave band called the Young Knives. Another difficulty I'm having, I think that the kind of striking rock star image is becoming increasingly kind of, I don't know, boring and mundane. A lot of bands should not really be on their sleeves. So I got sent these kind of shots of three kind of skinny guys from St Albans that wanted to be the hero of their sleeve. I kind of tried to disguise it as much as possible, but this, I don't know, I think it's crumpy, well, see that there, but it's cut here, either with a bit. That's just a few bits of my work. I'm hoping that I can carry on doing this for as long as I live. I am finding budgets slashed and stuff. I think as long as you root out the forward-thinking musicians, you can still get the design on vinyl, across books, special editions, and there still seems to be a lot of work out there for people like me. So fingers crossed.
Luke, thank you very much. Before we started, we were told that someone was about to come in and they heard that they asked who that was on the panel, and someone said, Vaughan Oliver, and they said, I'll see James Keaton and went away. So I hope everyone here is hanging on, about to hang on to every word. I think you have a film for us that is a silent film.
Yeah, I was hoping
that you'd
say very much about it. I mean, it's a short film, it's a 6-minute film, but the soundtrack isn't working. So if you want to run the quick time there, it's actually, it's a... My name is Vaughan, but I'm a recovering graphic designer. I take one day at a time. This is a medley of poster designs that I've done over the years. It's sort of 30 years in five.
Stone ground.
I'm going to take it from the top. There's an image of buckets right at the front.
Oh, he doesn't come in, doesn't he?
Do you want to go right back to the beginning? We get everything in.
What if you've got Uncle Slideshow?
It makes me think.
Stories to tell of the bow astray.
struggles in heaven and hell. Youth insecure again, such mighty dreams as all fair scenes of her promise tomorrow may bring.
Mid-70s with the miners' strikes and 3 days a week and warming one's hands around the candle. And this was kind of just before I went to college, Newcastle College, to study graphic design. At that point in time, I knew I wanted to be a graphic designer. I didn't know what a graphic designer was. I wanted to be a record sleeve designer. Once I got to college, they told me, well, record sleeve design, it's not a profession. The drummer does it. The drummer does the sleeve. So I was determined to prove them wrong. And in terms of timing, 1976, you know what I mean? There was a revolution, a youth revolution, against the economic, cultural status, and do it yourself. So I was fortunate to be part of that. I mean, you've seen the work, there's not really a punk aesthetic in there, but there was an attitude, really, that spurred a lot of people of that generation on to either form bands or indeed a little bit later, record labels. As an alternative to the mainstream, the old adage of kicking against the pricks with an independent distribution system, which was generally, the idea was, and I know it was at 4AD, the record label I kind of first got involved with, was the artist who was at the centre of the whole process. Creative direction was put into the hand of the artist, I'm saying artist, musician. So then it started a relationship, and I used to bump into this gentleman called Ivo Watts Russell, hyphenated, who just started a label called 4AD. We bumped into each other watching the same band, so there's a kind of an empathy for each other's taste in music, if you like. And I persuaded him he needed some consistency, a logo, and we both shared, actually, old-fashioned values in terms of care and quality and attention to detail. Then it started a relationship. I'm still working occasionally for 4AD today, but I think the story of the change over 3 decades might come over.
I think it will.
The course of the evening between a bunch of us.
I think it will.
Yeah.
You done?
Finished.
Good.
Finally, Kevin, he's done the show.
Before you show any more, I should just sketch. So, this shot, I took when I was studying photography. And I wanted to go see David Bowie play in concert, and I couldn't afford a ticket, so I thought the best way into the gig was to take a college camera case like my way in, and in those days they didn't really have photo passes. And I went to see Bowie at the Free Trade Hall in Manchester, and I felt I was in the wrong place for that shot. So a couple of weeks later I went to see him in Leeds, and I took one roll of film with me, I stood in exactly the place I wanted to wait for that picture. And I took that one shot when he did it. And V&A bought that from me maybe 10 years ago. And there was no photo, I wasn't there, or, you know, I wasn't there on the photo pass, I wasn't there shooting it for anyone. I did it for myself because I felt that's what I wanted to do. And then in my final year, punk started, and so I was able to photograph bands in Manchester. I worked closely with Buzzcocks and Joy Division. And I guess lots of people in other cities were doing the same thing. You know, there were loads of bands in Birmingham, in Bristol, everywhere. But I worked with a journalist, Paul Morley, and we used to bombard the music press with words and pictures. And, you know, we were in Manchester, bands were starting there, so we were able to push Manchester to the forefront, I guess. And then we'd make stuff up. We'd make things up about bands, we'd send pictures down, and they'd print it because they were too lazy to move out of London to find out what was going on. So that was my start. Then once I decided to take it seriously, it then becomes a bit different because you're having to earn your living from it. So the pictures you're going to see, there's a few record sleeves, and I've no idea what order they're in because he wasn't able to put them in order. So I think they're in some random alphabetical order. And there's probably half a dozen sleeves and half a dozen editorial images, and then I can talk about them. Might mention who they are.
Next slide.
Yeah. So that was, I was photographing Happy Mondays in Sitges near Barcelona, and we were on the roof of a hotel because it was the only place with any light by the time they managed to get out of bed. And I was photographing Sean and Bez under the HOT of hotel because I thought Summer of Love, hot, absolutely perfect. And then I realised what the next letter of hotel was. And I asked Sean to climb on the letter A. And I thought it would be a shot I could use in a book, maybe, but I didn't think it'd be, they'd put it on the cover of the NMA. I thought there'd be all sorts of litigation problems with Sean on the BBC of his life. But we ran that on the cover, and it was, you know, came the iconic cover.
Next.
Ian Curtis. Again, when I photographed Joy Division, I could only afford a couple of rolls of film because it was part of a bigger feature. The NME didn't really think Joy Division were that big a band. Wouldn't ever be big enough to go on the cover of the NME. So they were part of a feature about Manchester where they could just package Manchester and say, right, we've done that, you know, we don't have to mention Manchester for a couple of years. So it was Joy Division, Passage, and Spherical Objects. And I know you've all got every Spherical Objects album sleeve. And I took two rolls of film out that day, and, you know, we'd get paid £6.50 for a picture in the NME. And it cost me £10 a roll to shoot it. So when I shot that picture, that was right at the end of the session. I had three frames left. And I just wanted some solo pictures of Ian. And I got him to stand against this lamppost and look straight down the lens. Prior to that, when you work with bands, you quite often have to ask them what they want to do. And what they want to do is generally not very visual, although they think it is. And they wanted to be photographed queuing up for a bus. So I wasted three frames doing that. Then I was trying to take pictures of Ian on his own with the rest of them, trying to make him laugh. And I didn't want him to laugh because we had a very definite idea what we wanted him to look like. And finally, I just got them to one side and took those of Ian before we left and finished the session. That's not a music picture. No idea why that's in there. Well, it's just quite cool. That was the very first picture I took of the enemy, actually. I had a reputation at the enemy for killing people off for a while, and the very first shoot I did for the enemy was Mark Owen. The feature was going to be a day in the life of Mark Owen, and he died a week after we did the picture. And then I photographed Ian Curtis and he died. And I photographed Michael Hutchins and he died. And then I photographed Richie Edwards and he disappeared. So whenever the enemy didn't like somebody, they would say, Kevin, do you fancy photographing Sting? Because we really like him. So it was never used. Polly Harvey, that's just him because it's a nice picture. And again, it kind of breaks the rules of photography. That's the reason I like it. It's all background and very little else, but, you know, shot for a cover. And when you shoot an enemy cover, you've got to think, because A, put the logo on there, they're going to put three drop-ins of things that are totally inappropriate on there, and then they're going to put loads of cover lines and strap lines and try and put all the contents of the cover on there. And I blame people like this for that. So, ideally, I'd have liked it with an enemy logo and nothing else on there. But, you know, the editor has normally come from a literary background and the designers listen to them because that's who they're paying. Stone Roses covered in paint. That was a game for an enemy shoot where I wanted photographed them as a John Squire painting. And over the last few years, John Squire's been going out saying it was his idea. Well, it wasn't. It was his painting. It was my idea. Because John Squire supports Man United, he would not have painted the band in sky blue and white. When we did that picture, I rented it. They could only do it on a Sunday in Manchester. And I had to rent a studio from a fashion photographer there. And he was like John Pawson. He had three pencils lined up on his drawing board, and he had nothing else in there, and everything was equidistant. And I thought, I dare tell you what I'm about to do to your studio, mate. And we had to turn the place into a polythene queue before we did the shoot. And then I had this kind of romantic idea that John Squire would turn up almost dressed as some kind of lab OM 19th century artist and paint them, and I thought it would be a really painstaking job. And he turned up with about five different gallon cans of paint, and I put the band in place and we did several Polaroids of them. And then I said to him, okay, we're ready, can we put a base colour of white down? And I thought he'd get his brush out. I really did seriously think he'd get a brush out and start painting. And he opened this gallon can of paint and just threw it across the room. And then he did the same with the sky blue, and I thought we were going to have to pay for this guy to have a studio refurbished. And then he tip paint over himself and get in the shot, and then we built the colours on. And they were in this paint for about 2 hours. It was all emulsion paint, and it was very, very sticky and very, very cold and horrible. And at the end of the session, they decided to do a shot against the wall where they threw the rest of the paint over me. Fortunately, I was stuck behind the polythene, so I shot it through the polythene. And then they wanted the showers, and that's what I had to tell them. Because they wanted to shoot this on a Sunday, everywhere else in the studio was closed, and they had to get up and get themselves. And so they ended up having to get in the van dressed like that and go back to Ian's flat. All, I just had this kind of romantic, enlightened vision of them all sitting there, soaking each other and in the bath together, washing all the paint off. Maybe that would have made a better shot. Next. I've got some sleeves. This is when designers put words over your pictures and you've got no say in the matter. So, go on. Just run through this, bro. Morrissey tends to do his own sleeves. And tends to choose a photo from a previous session so it doesn't have to pay for it. That was the hat from Sir Rose's session, which I've still got, and that's their tour in this year. I think I'd like a quid in. pastiche of an Elvis slave and hoping I will not notice this. That cost him a bit of extra. That was Lee Hazelwood's last session before he died. I'm terrible, I don't know. It's not quite under.
No wonder you're asking other people to take you off one of
those. Absolutely, yeah. And again, with that photograph, which has obviously been used a lot, I think in a way has come to define the band, which is obviously what you want to do when you shoot a band. You want to, you know, you have all these ideas that you want to define. So to find a band in one shot is quite difficult. But that has lots of space in it, and the band are almost incidental to it. And I think you look at that and you know what kind of music they play. You know, that couldn't be take that. That has to be George. And I would say to Bernard, what I thought about that was that it defined them really, and the space and the architecture and everything said a lot about them. And he said, we didn't have any space in our music. And I said, that's why musicians never understand their own music. You know, it does have space in it, and they hated it when Martin Hannett produced them, because left to their own devices, they'd have been Bon Jovi things. So, you know, you have to, it's a collaborative effort. You have to work with them, but you have to push them in a certain direction. You can't always let them tell you what to do, because if they do, they take it very, very literally, and, you know, the absolute nadir of that is where they, you know, with musicians and with writers, they will get to hold a piece of paper up with words on it because they think that that helps to explain what's going on there as a picture and explain it farther graphically. Is that last one? Oh, no. And there's Blur as Blondie. We did a series of bathroom sleeves for the NME once, where we did bands parody of their favourite album sleeves. And I spent 5 hours putting those strips out to do that. And then when we actually looked at the cover, we realised they did photoshops on the straight lines. And I photographed Debbie Harry about 2 years after that, and I said to her, Dana had only shaved up to his knees. He was really worried about shaving above his knees. And she said, oh, tell him I do that.
She's still alive, so.
Yeah.
How are you doing? Are you?
I think we're there.
Are we? Good. Yes. Oh, that was a good 5 minutes. You done?
Yeah.
Okay.
I know, thank you.
Okay.
I think so, though.
Okay, so now you know exactly who the panel is. Lots of wonderful work that we've seen and interesting observations on the nature of photography on speed design. So I think what we've done is we've looked at the past and we've looked at the present too, the work that's going on at the moment. So what I want to do is I want to move to the future very quickly and just look at, see if we can get some sort of consensus or some sort of view on I just want to run through the panel very quickly and ask you to be fairly brief. I'm just going to ask you something about the nature of your work. And Bob, start with you. I wonder if you feel there's a difference between taking a photograph for editorial purposes or for promotional purposes, or actually taking the classic album cover shot. Do you think about it differently? Do some of your pictures that are intended for editorial end up as album covers?
Well, in my case, yeah, most of my work has been for editorial, and when it ends up on an album cover, it's usually something that I've done as part of a story or part of something else. There are occasional times when I got hired to do an album cover, and it requires a lot more thought. If you've got a specific idea, like the John Lennon Faces was a specific idea that they wanted to do, to have a series of faces all the same size, and so we shoot just that specific thing. But most of my work is just, you know, they like the picture, like Kiss, like the picture, and they put it on the cover. I don't generally get...
Do you mentally frame it, do you think?
Well, very welcome, yeah. If you know what you're saying, and what he was saying before about a magazine cover, you always have to leave extra room on the top for the magazine title and room on the side for all the, you know, headlines that go down the side, so you kind of put a person down on the right or left or something to leave space for that. I kind of like the square format of the album, you know, when you get to specifically do that, and then when I do get a job for that, I use the Hasselblad, which makes a square format picture. I don't know about the future of album covers, because I don't think people are making albums. They make albums now, you know, for
we'll
get to that. Okay, good.
We'll get that. I just have one other question, and that is, do you consciously, you try and get a lot of, I see a lot of personality in your pictures. You do, particularly the Leonard ones, you do close-ups of people. Kevin, for instance, I think is much more atmospheric. You just showed us the Joy Division on the bridge, masses of empty space on that. Do you think that people need to know who's made the music? Do they want to see the person who made it?
Absolutely. I think that's the point of the album covers. You know, traditionally you would look through albums in a bin and you would see a whole, you know, several hundred of them, and you would choose to buy the record because of what it looked like, and what it looked like was what the band would sound like. In other words, you assume that whoever's choosing that artwork, that's their taste, you know, and they're showing you what their style is. And so the album cover should show the person's style or their humor, or, you know, I remember a lot of people looked at the New York Dolls album cover and they bought it because they had to find out who the hell that was, who would look like that, and what could that possibly be. So yeah, I think that album covers, was the whole point of an album cover, was to draw attention to what the band's statement was. And you would assume, you know, you get some idea what it's going to sound like by what it looks like.
And Luke, you do something else. You use pictures of artists, but you, as you said, you fuck around with them. So use your phrase. And also, a lot of your work is illustrative.
Yeah.
It's non-figurative. And what's the advantage of having illustration, imagery, line images on the screen? What does that mean?
Well, I don't know. There's a disadvantage in the fact that I don't think there's a worrying lack of kind of charismatic rock star. You know, but I think back in the day, you know, obviously when you look at Steve's, a lot of these photographs I looked at today, I just think like acts have become increasingly kind of faceless, and I think for that reason, illustration, particularly abstract illustration, is on the rise. There's a lot of bands that they just don't have that kind of presence, like you're saying, we saw a sleeve, we saw a Bowie sleeve, or even an Elvis sleeve, you know, back before then, you kind of saw that artist excited you, and you wanted to sort of enter their world. Increasingly now, and you know, it's because music's changed as well, there's a hell of a lot of bedroom music being made and DIY stuff, and I think that's all very exciting, but I think the rise of illustration coincides with the kind of the lack of real rock stars. But I think at the same time is the unfortunate kind of thing about budget as well. And whereas you might have purely photographic work on in the kind of pop realms, where you know you're going to sell a million Beyonce albums or a million Adele albums or a million Will Young albums. That's all about just the very safe shot of the artist. But I think, illustration is definitely is there for kind of forward thinking artists, I think.
And how much of what you create in illustration is generated by the music? Do you always listen to the music when you?
95% of the time, yeah. occasionally if I kind of know, say a couple of major label jobs, if I get sent a couple of MP3s and I specifically choose kind of not to listen to it because I know it might kind of put me off the job for a start. Current
client.
Why
do you do it?
What's that? I think I've been lucky in that even bands I wouldn't necessarily buy, like the Young Knives, say, you know, it's still kind of verging on the experimental. It's not, I don't get sent the Will Youngs or the Take That, so I kind of know that although it may not be my quite specific kind of psychedelic cup of tea, or not, I know that bands like the Young Knives or the Prodigy at least try to do something a little bit more kind of exciting in the realms of kind of pop music. So. I guess I'm lucky in fact, I don't get sort of artists that are completely off the mark and have no interest in what I'm
So are you saying you would only work on something that you found ideologically, aesthetically, politically correct?
I think for if I was working for them, yeah.
You have to like, yeah. You have to like and approve.
If I was shooting the record slip, if I was shooting editorially, it doesn't matter because I can photograph somebody objectively, that's totally different, and I can make them look at complete autopsy if I want, which I...
Or even kill them.
Well, you know, I've killed several people, obviously. But, you know, I've photographed Jerome Jerome, and, you know, they're the worst people I've ever met in my life. And but we made it look like the worst people we'd ever met in our lives as well. But, editorially, that's fine, but if they then had come to me and said, we want you to do our sleeve, I couldn't have done it. Morally, I couldn't have done it.
Right.
There are certain things morally I can't do.
Well, that's the other thing.
One of them is...
It's a fine distinction, isn't it?
I can photograph David Cameron, but Cameron comes to me and says, will you do my promotional picture? I'd rather shoot it. So...
But for a lot of the time, it's never the band. I think if a band themselves, an individual, came to me and said, look, I've got money, I want you to do my sleeve, but a lot of the time it's some PR person or some managing person, and I'm going to have to see things like that as a job. And unfortunately, I think because the budgets aren't there anymore, that for every 10 acts that I might work with that I love, that, you know, the two or three that come in that I'm not 100% into, you end up taking as well, because I think if you're going to work in the realm of kind of record sleeve art, 89% will work anyway.
Yeah, I agree to some extent, but, you know, obviously there has to be a level where you won't go, and if you can't stand somewhere, and they say, but we'll give you 20 grand for doing it, it's very difficult to turn it down, but ultimately you have to turn it down morally. You know, I think you do.
Yeah, no, you do. I have.
There's another side to it where people will say to you, "Take his money," because he's a wanker. That's great too. But I think if you are doing a promotional picture for someone, then you have to like. Editorially, you don't have to like.
I don't know if I'd have to like him, but I'd have to hate him an awful lot to turn down 20 grand.
Well, that's what I'm thinking.
That's so American.
Vaughan.
When someone commissions a Vaughan Oliver sleeve, they get a Vaughan Oliver sleeve, don't they?
Adam?
What part of that?
What do you mean, get a Vaughan Oliver
sleeve? They get a Vaughan Oliver
sleeve. What do they get when they get me? They get a pretty...
So they don't want to say is
a conscientious professional that does their research, that reads the lyrics, that listens to the music, that listens to what the band wants. Does that kind of previous presentation give the impression that it all comes from here? It's a collaboration.
I'll ask the audience.
If it's a collaboration, you know, there's a, I think, you know...
But there's a Vaughan Oliver look. There's a voice
out there.
We just saw it.
Identify it. No, because... What I would say is,
every
time I do, I'll get angry in a minute. No, you couldn't put Colourbox sleeves or Lush sleeves or Ultra Vivid Scene sleeves on the Pixies or the Wolfgang Press or this model coil. Everything I do is born of the music. Where I was very fortunate, of a lucky man, was finding a label whose music I really enjoyed, and I was getting natural inspiration from the music. It was easy. But it was also a kind of case of it wasn't so easy, i.e. you're dealing with bands and you're taking the whole thing on board, and they might have kind of, you know, they've been working on this stuff for a year. It's their thing. And they've got their own aesthetic. And it's very interesting that the kind of divide over the years. A fantastic photographer, and he shot some beautiful people. And Bob saying, you know, a portrait on the front is about the music. The artist that I was working with from 1988 onwards, it wasn't an ugly label. There's some very attractive people on the label. But all of them said, we don't want a portrait. You know, there's a kind of sea change in attitude. We don't promote ourselves. We are in the music. So kind of work with the music, if you can reflect the music. And it might seem a
you know, pretentious aspiration, but that's what I was trying to do. So I don't think they get a Vaughan Oliver Steve. I think it's a collaboration where I've concentrated on all their details and all their wants, and try to kind of echo through my system pretty great.
Can I say, I saw you photograph your pearls. I was really...
Arrogantly.
You designed the Lush sleeve and you designed the Pixies. So whenever I photograph those pearls for the LMA, I always felt slightly intimidated by the fact that Vaughan designed these sleeves, and I felt this obviously is quite good.
Can everybody hear?
Yeah.
Well, Vaughan had designed sleeves, and so for the LMA, I wanted to photograph them in a more arty way, because we always felt 4AD bands were quite arty because of him. Because irrespective of what they sounded like, because of him, and so I would do quite more art project based things with his bands. So when I photograph Lush, for instance, we'd always do really, really over the top art sleeves. We'd do.
So did you enjoy that?
Yeah, I liked it a lot. It pushed me much more.
Did it give you a freedom?
It gave me a lot of freedom, but it made me think a lot more about it. The same with Pixies, and then you look at Select and you look at Melody Maker, and you know, they were kids at Select that go out with Lush. And to readers of Select or Sounds, Lush were a band who just went out on this, threw up on a Friday night, and were arrested Saturday morning. Whereas in the NME, they were seen as this impossibly arch art band because of the way I shot them. We build on that each time. And that was because of 4AD. If Lush hadn't been on 4AD, I wouldn't have thought of it.
I'm getting signals that we should be wrapping up. So I want to finish with two questions for each of you. Anyway, it was your 12-minute film that did it. That's the problem. I want to ask each of you two questions, and I need short, succinct, snappy answers. My first question is, do album covers have a future? And then, once you've answered that, name your favourite album cover. Okay, you can show it then. Do album covers have a future?
Covers don't have a future because everybody sees them that size on their iPod. The only people it has a future for are people of our generation who buy 120 quid reissues when it's all repackaged and reboxed. My favourite albums, and it was actually like carrying this around tonight, was like I was going to someone's party where you take five favourite albums. And these are my favourite album covers. It's that Rolling Stones one. You couldn't do that on your iPod. It's that Rolling Stones one.
Is that the 3D one?
Yeah,
oh.
You couldn't do that on your iPod. And even better,
you will be asking 10 years
now. Even better, it's got that inside. Try and do that on your iPod. It's got a little disc.
Can you change the record?
He's making a fair point.
Wheelie thing. That. It's just a great illustration that when it's reduced to 1-inch square looks like fuck all.
What are you kind of boiling down to? You know, an object, something to have and to hold, to kind of take something
you
from.
You can stroke it,
you can smell it, it's something. It's a signifier. It's a signifier for the band. You know, it kind of means as much as their hairstyle or the jeans that they wear. It's a gateway into the music. It's a number of things that have gone from that size down to that size. And what happened when they put it in that size? They invented, it's the worst invention of the 20th century, plastic jewel case. What a misnomer. It took all of that tactile enjoyment out of the home for the music.
not bigging up the package too much. You know, the lady at ECM designer, she said, you know, all the record sleeve is there for to stop the vinyl rolling off the shelf. So, is this idea also kind of a page in the diary? It's the idea of collectors. There's something innate in all of us, isn't it? The hunters and gatherers, or hunters and collectors, something like that. The book's going the same way. What are shelf manufacturers going to do?
What are you not going to decide?
Is that the album cover?
It's either one of Bob's, one of Luke's, or one of too polite. No, I it's a portrait actually, it's Jonathan Richmond and the Modern Lovers. Where there's a lovely kind of homoerotic, beautiful light that always just it comes off the page.
I think there is a future. I've designed more 12-inch vinyl sleeves in the last year than I have done in the last 5 years. It's just a case of sourcing out the new independent DIY labels, the kind of forward-thinking artists who may only do 300, 500 copies, but they want to do
it's
it
niche.
On... Yeah, it's niche. Yeah. There are so many kind of pop-up DIY labels. I mean, you know, so I set up a... I love the 7-inch format, so I set up a label with a friend, kind of, you know, 3 or 4 years ago. Do small runs, 500 hand-printed sleeves. They fly out the door. It doesn't make $1 million, but it kind of like it funds itself. You know? And I think it's just a case of seeking out forward-thinking artists, and even if they're, you know, multi-million sellers, and the forward-thinking ones like the Radioheads or you know, bands like Oasis, but they love to release it on that kind of vinyl format, and I'm hoping that it won't die. Favourite sleeve, purely for my kind of love of that kind of psychedelic illustration, Disraeli Gears, Martin Sharp, with Cream.
Very 60s.
Very 60s today.
I don't think there's a lot of future in art, in album cover art, because there are no albums anymore. Is the future for an art director who can make, you know, albums for the bands that can afford to make that special product, they make 300 for the rare collectors. But as a mass market item, where stores would carry albums, that doesn't exist anymore. An album cover that would reduce to a YouTube link. If you want to find out about a band, you click on the link and see what band. I mean, I just got a button the other day that is the album, and you can actually wear it. There is art direction in that, and you want a button to look good, and it's kind of unique. It has little volume controls on the back, and you're on the button, and that was the whole album. And just because they're trying to make a product, because a friend of mine said the other day, what if your entire musical output didn't exist except on a screen in front of you, as links, as a list? Like, there never is any physical product. And yeah, there is a tactile quality to be able to hold the record and to feel it. My favorite album cover is actually, my most favorite was the Between the Buttons. For a Mike Rose picture of Rolling Stones, Stayed Up All Night at Dawn's Great Glory picture. And I think one of the things I liked about it, I like Buttery pictures, obviously, is that the art, the graphics on the album cover are between the buttons.
No longer approach me to talk about sleeve design. It's as if
a platform that you had as a young designer no longer exists. And I think that's one of the things I regret. I don't regret the end of the album coming at a little tiny scale due to the result. But I think that's designers, young designers, students, you need to find out another platform. So
that's a pretty good point.
I think if you understood, wrap up there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Questions.
Thank,
two questions.
Not got time, half an hour late. If you turned up earlier, it would have been alright.
We've been waiting for.
If anybody wants to ask Kevin any questions in person later, then do feel free. I want to thank everybody, Adrian, Luke, Bob.